Good morning, beloved saints of Maranatha Bible Church. Well, as you can well see, we're not again in worship together in our beautiful sanctuary. We are, to the best of our abilities, though, as a church, following the coronavirus guidelines for America. I truly am missing the faces, smiles, and the hugs of not being personally among you. I'm kind of identifying with all the professional, collegiate, even high school athletes who soon may be allowed to get back into their games, but with no spectators attending, it's just not going to be exciting, motivating, or even challenging. You know, not being in my pulpit, not seeing all of you in the pews, exhorting, encouraging, and equipping you for the work of the ministry, it's just not the same enthusiasm. But I imagine, as the old saying goes, a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. So until we get the all clear signal to return to some normality and sanity of ministry, we'll praise the Lord for our media output. You know, you and I are no doubt still scratching our heads as to what part God is playing in this scenario. The fact of it being global, I think it has to be bigger than any human orchestration. I heard a preacher say last week, sometimes God allows what he hates that he may accomplish what he loves. You get that? Sometimes God allows what he hates that he may accomplish what he loves. I think as believers in Christ that we can really have great hope in that statement. That when we get through it, and all of us will get through it, we'll see the blessings and the benefits this has accorded us. Our message today will kind of be different than a sermon. I'm going to have some of our leadership, pastors, elders, deacons, give a short testimony of what this quarantine has taught them and maybe encouraged them as they're holding steadfast to their faith. First, though, many years ago, I was mentored into this truth that the spiritual health and strength of any church is that when a leader is taken out, the ministry does not miss a beat. In 1999, I was taken out for 6 months overcoming cancer surgery. 5 years later, in 2004, again removed and on the sidelines with a quadruple bypass. I can assuredly, due to our leadership, tell you Maranatha did not miss a beat. In fact, on both occasions, my return saw a substantial growth. Maybe I should leave again. You know, relative to spiritual growth in a church, I love the humor of Steve Brown. He's a pastor. He's an author and he has a radio ministry. And when he refers to his own Presbyterian roots, said, the Presbyterians are a so well-oiled machinery that if the Holy Spirit was taken out, everything would continue just the same. This is why I applaud with a sense of humble pride the leadership of our staff, able to keep our church afloat like a ship moving forward to its design port, powered by the Holy Spirit. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, noted 19th century English Baptist evangelist and preacher, in reference to men worthy of ministry and men who are not so worthy of ministry, said this. He said, this prayer would be the very last one I would hope to ever pray. Lord, send to thy church men filled with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Give to any denominations and churches such men, and its progress must be mighty. But to those college gentlemen of great refinement and profound learning, but of little Holy Spirit fire and grace, dumb dogs which cannot bark, and straightway the denomination must decline. Well, I'm confident that Maranatha Bible Church will not decline. Listen now to some of our pastors, elders, and deacons. These are your go-to men alongside of me, your senior pastor. And don't forget, because you and I are in Christ, as the hymn writer once penned, it is well with my soul. God bless, Pastor Mizell.
Happy quarantine. This is Sean with Maranatha Bible Church, and it's something I wanted to share about a little bit about what God's been doing during this time in our lives and teaching our family. And it's something that's pretty critical to our relationship and our relationships in the body and our relationship with God, and that's the understanding of the term mercy. And Jesus talked about it in Matthew 5:7. He said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." And this word mercy is an interesting word. Some people have defined it as not getting what we deserve. It could also be defined as compassionate or compassion, loving kindness. And in these times in which I know I've got teenage boys at home and a baby and a wife, and we're all in the house together a large part of our days lately. And that term is something we are experiencing firsthand, is that term mercy, and how hard it is sometimes to give mercy or to be merciful. Yet very often during this time, we expect mercy. We want it, we crave it. And I can't help but really look at what God did for us and how he was merciful to us and how he is merciful to us. And I know many people can probably identify with the idea of not getting what we deserve and how God desires us to be merciful, to follow that example and to be compassionate and to be loving and kind and to not give people what we think they deserve, and how important that is and how vital it is, even in our relationships in our homes, in our relationships in the world, and in our relationships even within the body of Christ. We need to be merciful. And when we don't want to give mercy, I think it's very important that we understand the mercy we've been given and to reflect upon that. And that can be life-changing, and it has been for us. It's something that we're tested on every single day. And it's really a blessing that we're able to discuss this. We're able to look into the Word of God and see where God talks about mercy. He talks about it in Matthew through Jesus. He talks about it in James. And there's some really good, deep stuff when you really look up the word mercy. So I'd encourage you to open the Bible, open your Word, and get into it and see what God has for you regarding mercy, because he is a merciful and a mighty and a loving God. Hope you guys are doing well and staying healthy, and we look forward to seeing you again real soon. Take care.
Well, hello, Saints of Maranatha. It's an honor to get a few minutes to speak with you today. You know, when I was about 5 years old, my grandpa Ciccio, and that's nicknamed for Francesco or Frank in Italian, he loved to hear me sing. And on holidays like Easter, Christmas, any family gathering, he'd get me up, he'd click his wine glass, stand me on a chair at the head of the table, and announce that Frankie is going to sing. Now, he only spoke broken English and would love to hear me sing in his Italian language from his old country. So he, along with my father, taught me the first Italian song I ever learned, and I believe it's the world's most recognized, O Solo Mio. Well, interestingly enough, then last year, a wonderful Christian friend of mine and fellow entertainer, Vinnie Holman of Hendersonville, North Carolina, gave me the lyrics to a hymn to the tune of O Solo Mio. And it's called Down From His Glory. She encouraged me to sing it for the members of Maranatha Church. Well, good intentions being what they are, members of Maranatha Church, I waited a bit too long to sing it for you in person. Well, this past Easter Sunday, I thought it might be a nice idea to merge the secular with the sacred by singing a bit of O Solo Mio in Italian and combine it with the Christian hymn Down From His Glory, and I sent it to my fans. And because no matter how this Wuhan virus crisis works out, whether God through his grace brings America through and returns us to quote-unquote normal and gives to us as church a revival and an extended period of years to more boldly share the gospel of Jesus Christ and getting tens of millions into his kingdom. And to my mind, that'd be the only good reason for God to bless and to restore the opening of America as we knew it. Or whether God is allowing the pre-tribulation time clock to run down to 0 hour, where the window of salvation through grace is finally closed, and that he may be asking and allowing each of us to endure and even suffer a bit longer and even a bit more so that all of those who we love may, in his mercy, have at least one last opportunity to be brought to their knees and saved in the nick of time, before the window is closed and he raptures us and his church. In this crisis, I'm reminded and being schooled that it is his kingdom that must ultimately come. It is his will that ultimately must be done, and that my will and desires must be brought in line with his, because it is for his glory and not my needs that we're called to be followers of Christ. That God did in fact come down from his glory, that he is faithful, he is good to his word and to his promises. So, in remembrance of my grandpa and grandma and family at Easter dinner table, a table long time ago, in honor of my Lord, whose gift to me is the promise that I will again be invited by my grandpa to come to the head of the table and sing for him in the mansion prepared for him in heaven, I humbly ask you to listen to the song Down From His Glory, which should be the last video on this post, or it can be heard by you going to YouTube and typing in Frank J, my middle initial, Todaro. Frank J. Todaro, Down From His Glory. That should bring it up. God bless you, and may he give each of us the grace through this crisis to hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant," when we are with him in heaven. Blessings and prayers to all of you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, Maranatha family. Hope you guys are doing well with your social distancing, staying healthy, staying away from stores and things like that, and just making sure that you're safe. You know, the funny thing about this whole social distancing thing, when it started, the madness behind it, me and my wife were out to dinner a couple months before this whole thing started, and we were just having a good Friday night out at down on Atlantic Avenue, just having communion and fellowship together. We were discussing just a thought that I've been having about that, just knowing that non-believers have the same thing. You know, nobody would be down in Atlantic hanging out or having dinner if there weren't other people there, if there weren't other people having dinner or wandering around just taking a look at the shops. So Pastor, I was talking to Pastor, and he was gave me a book by A.W. Tozer about understanding a little bit about communion and fellowship. And this is one of the things that I got from it. The communion of saints then means an intimate and loving sharing together of certain spiritual blessings by persons who are on equal footing before the blessing in which they are sharing. So as me and my wife were having dinner and we were sharing in that blessing and sharing in that communion together, just thinking about us not being here in Maranatha, not having fellowship together. But remember this, as you guys are having fellowship and communion at home with the Lord, us deacons and other leaders in the church, we're doing the same as you. So we are, in a sense, having communion and fellowship. So guys, till we see you again, we love you. We'll see you soon.
Hello, everyone. Pastor Norm here with my lovely assistant, Miss Sandy, just letting you see that we're in good shape and doing fine, even in this COVID-19 coronavirus scare that we're in the middle of. Sandy, would you go fix lunch, put another log on the fire, and fix my truck, and then come and tell me why you're leaving me? No. Okay, honey, you can step out. Thank you very much. Love you. Very popular Bible verse these days since the COVID-19 is 2 Timothy 1:7. I'm hearing it over and over. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Now, there's two kinds of fear that the Bible talks about. In this verse, it's used in a Well, in a negative sense, it's to be afraid or timid. It's to be dreadful, full of dread. It's to be fearful, full of fear. Faithless. In other words, for fear, the other word for fear is not this one, which is negative, but it's a positive one, and it talks about a reverence or to revere something. Psalm 111, verse 9, in the King James Version, holy and reverend is God's name. Now, I've been ordained by Florida Bible College, so legally I can use the title Reverend before my name. But Psalm 111, verse 9 says that that describes God's name, not mine. And so I don't use it. But now if you want to address me as my New King James says, it's holy and awesome is God's name. Now, if you want to call me Awesome Norm, I'll set aside the other thing, and we'll go with that. No, of course, I'm joking. Awesome is way too overused. We ought to reserve it for God. It is a fabulous word. Now, four times in the Bible, justified, the just shall live by faith, not fear. Remember, God has not given us the spirit of fear, that faithless thing. But four times in the Bible, Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, Romans, Galatians, Paul uses it, and then the writer of Hebrews, and it's the just, or those that are justified before God, believers. The just shall live by faith. Now, the idea of living there, the just shall have eternal life by faith in Christ. The just shall live their life once they've trusted Christ by faith in Christ. So it goes either ways. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says, without faith it's impossible to please God. For those that come to Him must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Faith, pretty special. F-A-I-T-H. You know, I like acrostics where the first letter of each letter makes a word, like faith. F-A-I-T-H. Forsaking all, I trust Him. The word trust, I like that too. T-R-U-S-T. To rely upon something or someone totally. That fits the bill completely. So He's not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power, there's the word, of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Power. You've heard it many times. The Greek word is dunamis. It means dynamite. That's our English word. Kind of interesting, I've got a note here that last Sunday, 25 years ago, April 19th, 1995, the Alfred P. Murrah Federal Building in Oklahoma City was bombed. 186 people died. Recovery lasted 16 days. A homemade bomb, 4,800 pounds of diesel fuel oil and gray ammonium nitrate fertilizer. Talk about power. All nine floors collapsed, including the America's Kids child care on the second floor. Many of them died or were badly maimed. A lot of dunamis, a lot of dynamite, a lot of power. I cried as I read that from the Reader's Digest. They had a reprint of it from 25 years ago. I cried as I read about those children and so forth. I was asked to have a favorite verse, I guess you'd call it, for the yearbook at Florida Bible College, and I chose Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. So God hasn't given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. That love is agape love, God's kind of love. There's three kinds of love that are mentioned in the Bible. Eros, that's erotic love. I'm glad for that because of that, I'm a great-grandfather, erotic love, and I don't want to make fun of it, but Sandy we have three great-grandchildren. Let me get it right here in a moment. Six grandchildren, three great-grandchildren. She's Gigi Ma, and I'm Gigi Pop. Now, Pop is like Dad or something like that, but it's for this Pop. The kids can't do it. They think I'm a magician because I can do it. And they put their finger up there. They put their finger in my mouth. They can't get it to pop. So I'm Gigi Pop. But here we go with erotic love. Thank you, God. Phileo love. It's a love of, it's a brotherhood kind of love. It's a family, a familial kind of love. And then God's love, agape. Agape love says, I love you. Whether you ever love me or not, you cannot do anything to deserve it. God just loves you. 1 John chapter 4, verse 10, herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the satisfying payment, the propitiation for our sin, the payment, the only payment that totally satisfies God. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter, remember? How we're to agape love one another. Jesus said, love each other like I've loved you. And then the last one, not a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and a sound mind. A sound mind means a disciplined mind. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Every thought. God knows what you think and why you think it. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he, Proverbs says. You may not be what you think you are, but what you think, you are. Now, I'm going to read about the Lord Jesus. It's called the kenosis from Philippians 2, and I'll be brief. Let this mind, your thoughts now, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it something to be held on to, no, but willingly gave up looking like God or being God in all of his attributes. He didn't stop being God, but let me just read here. Being in the form of God, he did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a servant, and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him, given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, things in heaven, things on earth, things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. So there's just some thoughts on a very popular these days verse of Scripture, 2 Timothy 1:7. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Let's have a word of prayer together. Father, thank you for taking care of us during this very difficult time in the world's history. I pray for your close, comforting presence. You're always there. You said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, but may we receive that love and power and sound mind, a disciplined mind. Thank you, Father, for this privilege to share with your church, your people, this good news, the good news of eternal life by faith alone, in Christ alone. Asking it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you very much. Got tracts? If not, get some. Always don't leave home without it. The good news of eternal life. God bless you. Bye for now.
Hey guys, it's Chris. What's going on? Just kind of wanted to share a little bit, at least my part for this Sunday, and obviously I'll be speaking mostly towards the central, but if you're watching, feel free to tag along in your Bibles and whatnot. So, just leading up to context to what I've been reading this last week, I've been in the book of Genesis, personally, in the last couple weeks, and so where I'm at right now is actually on Joseph, and specifically Joseph getting thrown in the prison. With everything going on, lockdowns around the United States, people stuck at home, I could guess how that could kind of feel like prison for a lot of people. So I'm just going to share a little bit from what I read in the last couple days. It's Genesis 39. It's going to be just real quick, 21 through 23. And it says, "But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy, and he gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners who were in prison, whatever they did there. It was his doing. The keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it prosper." Now, up until this point, Joseph was betrayed by his brothers, thrown into a ditch, sold into slavery, came to Egypt, was a slave, got a little position of power as a higher slave. Then his master's wife thought he was nice looking and came on to him. And then he, in the last attempt of her coming on to him, he ran out. So she came to her husband saying that it was vice versa, that he came on to her. And so Joseph was put into prison. Now what I just read is, while Joseph's in prison, he's still being blessed by God. God's mercy is still on Joseph, even to the point where the head guy of the prison decides, "I'm going to put Joseph in charge of the other prisoners." Why? And it says right there, the Lord was with him. Now, we're still in a waiting game with what's going on. I know schools have been canceled. I know Central, specifically for us guys, we haven't had Central in like 2 months. And I know personally for me, that's a real bummer. I look forward to every Wednesday night. I love hanging out with you guys and talking to you guys. And I know your leaders do too. And so, you know, with everything going on, we just need to remember that God's in charge. His sovereignty is going to guide us through whatever's going to happen in the next few months. You know, and like Joseph, I mean, if we're sticking to what God has for us, he's going to give us his mercy. He's going to make us prosperous, even if it is at home. And sometimes at home, man, it's boring. I get it. Being trapped in the house all day, I would go nuts myself. You know, personally, God's blessed me, and I'm able to go to work every day. But even on the weekends, man, it gets kind of boring, especially without going to church and without seeing you guys on Wednesday nights. And I'm sure some of the leaders can attest to that. But guys, you just got to remember that, you know, even when times are tough, we need to put our faith and trust in what God has for us to do and see what he has for us to learn. Joseph spent the next 7 years in prison. That's a long time. We're only quarantined for a few months. I know it might feel like 7 years, but we're only quarantined for a few months. And yet God had so much to show him while sitting in that solitude of prison. And obviously, as we can see from the text, he had much to do being in charge of the prisoners. So guys, look for what God has for you to do while you're sitting at home. You know, obviously you're not going to school, and I get that, and you miss your friends. And if you're a senior, man, I'm really sorry that, you know, there's a lot of graduation stuff going on that isn't going to be happening. But guys, again, and we just look to what God has for us in these times like this. And man, not only is he going to teach us stuff, he's going to grow us. And our faith is going to be so much more than what it was going into this thing and coming out. And I know personally for me, like I said, it has been a struggle to not see you guys every Wednesday night. But you know what? We get to do these videos like this. And I do get to talk to some of you via text messaging. And it's those little moments like that is what makes it worth it. So guys, just remember that I know times might be not so great right now, but God is in control. And we just need to trust that even when we don't see what he's doing. Thank you, guys, and I can't wait to see you.
Well, church, I hope you enjoyed the testimonies that you've heard today from some of our elders and deacons. And I hope it's been encouragement to you, knowing that, that even us as a leadership in the body of Christ, we're still one, we're still committed and we're still trusting in God to come through this. And so it's wonderful to hear what God is doing in the lives of these men. So again, remember that every Tuesday evening during our prayer house ministry, the gentlemen, we're getting together, the elders and deacons, at 6 o'clock, and we're having our prayer house teleconference. We're praying for each and every one of you. We're going down the roster, looking at our directory and our care groups, and we're praying for the body of Christ. And we're meeting next week, actually, in person, social distancing, yes, but we're meeting in person to talk about the plans for reopening of Maranatha Bible Church and how soon we can do that and what that's going to look like. So pray for us as we're so excited about coming together again in the body of Christ. So stay encouraged. And on that note, I want to leave you with one passage. In my scripture reading these past several weeks, I've been trying to incorporate a psalm into my scripture reading. And a couple days ago, I read Psalm 44. And it's a beautiful passage because the psalmist is a little bit perplexed. They had gone into battle and they had been destroyed, absolutely. And it felt like the hand of God wasn't even with them and they had been removed. And the psalmist, in some perplexing transparency, even says, Lord, why did we deserve this? I mean, I could see if we weren't following you. I could see if we were doing the wrong thing. Or I could see if we weren't staying close to you and honoring you. But we have been. And we still lost this battle. God, why? Why did this happen? And he goes through the entire psalm just kind of questioning and asking God, what did we do wrong? What are we missing? And he doesn't come to a good conclusion. But he ends this psalm in a beautiful way. Psalm 44, verse 26. And the psalmist ends his plea, his perplexity, his conversation with God, and says this in verse 26. Rise up and help us. Rescue us because of your unfailing love. You know, wherever you are today, I mean, if you feel downtrodden, if you feel discouraged, if you're trying to figure out why this is happening, what's going on in your life, and you're like, Lord, I'm trying to stay in the Word, I'm trying to stay close to you, why is this happening? You know what, when you don't have the answer, and many times we don't, why not do what the psalmist did, is just to lay it at the altar of God, lay it at the feet of God, and say, God, beg, rise up and help me, rescue me. Not because I deserve it, but because of your unfailing love. Psalm 44, verse 26. You know, we've got two more things here on the service today. The next is a song from some guys in our ensemble singing The Power of the Blood. And that's where the power is, in the blood of Jesus Christ. So we have everlasting life and the assurance of it. And then the video will end with that song that Frank Todaro mentioned earlier, O Solo Mio, Down from His Glory. It's a beautiful song. It's what an appropriate way to end our service today. So again, Maranatha, we love you. We look forward to seeing you real soon. Stay encouraged, stay in the Word, and stay spiritually hydrated. God bless.
In the bird. Che bella cosa, una giornata sole, un'aria serena, una tempesta, per l'aria fresca, pare già una vista. Che bella cosa, una giornata del sole. Giornata del sole, più bella ne è. Oh, sole mio, sta in fronte a te. O sole, o sole mio, sta in fronte a te, sta in fronte a te. Down from his glory, everlasting story, my God and Savior came, and Jesus was his name. Born in a manger, to his own a stranger, a man of sorrows, tears and agony. Without reluctance, flesh and blood, his substance, he took the form of man, revealed God's hidden plan. Oh, glorious mystery, sacrifice of Calvary, and now I know thou art the great I am. Oh, how I love him, how I adore him, my breath, my sunshine, my all. Savior, and all God's fullness dwelleth in him. Oh, how I love him, how I adore him, my breath, my sunshine, my all in all. The great Creator became my Savior, and all God's fullness dwelleth in him. The great Creator became God's fullness dwelleth.